Welcome to Bone to Pick. We are here tonight at the Manhattan School of Music here in New York City, and I am very pleased to interview our featured artist of the month, bass trombonist extraordinaire, Mr. Dave Taylor. Dave has sculpted an incredible career by any estimation. He's a virtuoso on the instrument. He has been the studio kingpin the 70s, 80s, 90s.
Kingpin. I like that.
not much recording going on in New York that Dave Taylor wasn't on. And in the past 25 to 30 years, he's forged an internationally renowned solo career. Very impressive on a number of levels. In particular, what I find extremely impressive is that he's done it on an instrument that pre-Dave Taylor wasn't really thought of as a solo instrument so much. So he's paved a way for himself and for more bass trombonists to follow, and quite an impressive thing. On a personal level, Dave and I have known each other. I should say I've known Dave for a better part of 25 years. Safe to say we haven't always seen eye to eye.
But, safe to say.
I guess the night we almost got in a fight at Natalie Cole concert at Avery Fisher Hall might be a, when I say fight, I mean fist fight.
Fist fight, yeah, it was real. But it was real for me with Jaco backstage there, and it was real for me with Pierre Boulez there, too.
Well, I appreciate
I'm not proud of that, don't get me wrong, you know.
Well, I appreciate being in that level of company. I'm not sure I'm worthy of that.
You are worthy. No, you are worthy of that.
But anyway, I will say this. Dave and I have done a lot of playing together over the years and a lot of great playing. Bob Minster's band comes to mind. Yeah. Lots of recording in New York. And I think one of the things that showed me is that New York is a great place in terms of different styles and personalities being able to coexist and make music together and really have a platform.
You know, for my 40th birthday, I had a Studio Rainbow Coalition 40th birthday party at my house.
Very cool.
We rented a tent in the backyard, and I had all the various cliques because I was very lucky. I crossed all the cliques at that time, and it was very interesting. So I had to figure out a way, and at that time it was Jesse Jackson had his Rainbow Coalition.
Right, right.
So I figured out, right, Studio Rainbow Coalition.
Does that work like it worked the Jewish like a bass trombone player the same right. as Jesse Jackson?
It worked like a charm. Worked like a charm.
Well, Eddie, Dave,
until everybody got crazy at the, not angry, but we had a good time at that party.
And, partaking of banned substances? No, nothing like that, of course. But, well, listen, Dave, it's great that you're here tonight. Thank you for taking time out. I know you just got back from India, so we appreciate you taking time out. Why don't we start right from the beginning? You grew up in Brooklyn.
Yes.
And you attended Juilliard. Maybe you could talk a little bit about how you ended up on the bass trombone, what your experience was like at Juilliard, things along those lines.
I was very lucky. I was in the sixth grade of public school in New York in the 50s. The public school system had great music departments. And I took a music aptitude test, which I guess was very rudimentary. Luckily, I wasn't absent that day in the auditorium, a bunch of the kids. And Mr. Saslow came. He was in the junior high. Mr. Saslow, George Saslow, a marvelous, marvelous educator. So I got in somehow, I don't know how. And we all started on trumpet. And about a month in, I was pretty good. About a month in, he comes out with a tuba, and he says, "Who thinks they're big enough to play this bright, shiny tuba?" And of course, I was the runt, you know, the little kid. So I got the tuba, and then he needed a tuba player in the senior band, an orchestra. So I had to accelerate very quickly, and I played Tubby the tuba and all that. And I was a tuba player. Helped me out in the studio career too, because in the '60s, when I started subbing for Alan Raff, there were very few tuba doublers. So I went in, my first show was under the apple tree. I might have mentioned to you earlier, Art Farmer was sitting right behind me. The conductor was a guy named Hal Hastings, and he was always looking at me. And then I realized he had a roving eye. One eye was like always out there, and one eye was over there. So he wasn't really looking at me, just good. And then that was pretty successful. So I used to suffer him a lot. This was when I was at Juilliard. Very interesting, you know.
How was it getting in, like, the audition process, say, getting into Juilliard, is it similar to the way it is now? Or is
I don't know. It might have been a little more lenient because I took up the tenor trombone when I was a senior in high school. My kid brother had a trombone in the house. Where my mother or father couldn't get me home from school, which was pretty far away, I couldn't get the tuba home, but the trombone was always there. I really never liked the trombone. It was the only brass instrument I couldn't play. I was a good baritone horn player, good tuba player. I was a pretty good tuba player. I got in the Oldboro Orchestra. I loved the tuba, but the slide was very different for me, but it was in the house, you know. So, I auditioned. I wasn't a good reader, a very bad reader, as a matter of fact. I could read high school umpah parts and stuff. But so when I auditioned for Juilliard, I auditioned on the Haydn Trumpet Concerto Second Movement. Da 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 do da 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 da. You know that one. It's very simple, very right. I wasn't good at the sight reading thing, but they let me in. And when I started teaching at Manners College, Mr. Diantinis, he was a French horn player in the Philharmonic at the time. He was on the board. I used to hug and kiss this guy every time I saw him in the hall. Mr. Diantinis, I'd give him a kiss because those guys were lenient. For some reason, they let me in. They let me into Manhattan. I didn't want to go to Manhattan though because the guy I wanted to study with was a guy named Davis Schumann. Davis Schumann. Darius Milhaud wrote for him. Ernest Bloch wrote for him. He was a friend of Hindemith. This guy was, he did transcriptions. Sound familiar? I mean, that's probably, he was my beloved teacher. And he invented an angular trombone. I don't know if you ever heard of that.
I have heard of that.
Right, and I actually owned one. I'm sorry I had to sell that. I couldn't afford to buy a bass trombone when I eventually shifted, but the procedure was simple with this thing. He was a civil engineer, David Schumann. He died young. He died in his 50s during my second or third year at Juilliard. And I never gave a school recital. I was able to skip after. I was here for 6 years at Juilliard. A Bachelor of Science degree for 5 years. We take extra academic credits. And then a Master of Science degree for the 6th year. So even though I had problems with academe, they actually made me qualified for a lot of different stuff. So the angular trombone was, the idea was when we play the trombone, we actually move our arms into the center. Our arms don't go straight out. Mm. But if you move the slide on an 11 degree angle, the slide goes that way, but your arm is actually going straight out. So it facilitates shorter arms and this and that. Yeah. I didn't quite catch on.
Yeah. Right. Good idea, nonetheless. Right.
But so Juilliard was very interesting. I couldn't get into the regular theory class at the beginning because I didn't know even the stems go up or down on a D. You could write it either way. I was that rudimentary. So they sent me to Mrs. Bamberger's class with a bunch of other people there, but we didn't know anything about it. And they wouldn't let me in any ensembles. I was actually in one big ensemble. They couldn't keep you out of all of them. So I immediately went to the outside, to the street. I was very ambitious. And so I started playing in as many community orchestras as I can get into.
Wow.
And then by the third, fourth year, then I started getting into, it really turned around for me when I switched to the bass trombone.
So you were a tenor trombone.
I was a tenor trombone player. Okay. I was a senior in high school, and for the first two or three years at Juilliard.
Okay.
Then one of the guys, I went to the Music Academy at the West one summer, and somebody put a bass trombone on my hand. I said, oh, that's nice, blah, blah. But then the following year, somebody said the Liederkranz Orchestra of New York, that was a German social club, needed a bass trombone player to play in one of their gigs. So I said, yeah. So I borrowed the school's horn, which was a leaky Con 72H, but I dug it. Mm-hmm. And I played that for a year. And as soon as I started playing the bass trombone, it must be because of the tuba, it was like within 6 months, man, it was like, boom. I was like, wow. And then I bought my own horn finally. I bought a Holton. Nobody was playing on a Holton, but I dug it because it wasn't as heavy as the Bach in terms of producing a tone. It was much easier to produce a tone, and the sound had brilliance to it, you know? Mm-hmm. And even when you play soft, you could be heard. Mm. You know, I say when you're playing those big, heavy horns sometimes, you play soft. Although they can carry the tone longer because the metal rings longer, there's something about brilliance. I'm not afraid of brilliance in the sound, you know? Mm-hmm. I don't call it, what do they call that? Bright. I don't like bright. Brilliance, I like. You know, you hear great bass singers in an opera, you can always hear them because they have brilliance in their sound. All right.
So you got out of Juilliard then, when was that, about?
60. I came in at 62, I got out at 68.
68, okay. Right. And so at that point you were already pretty much fixed.
I had auditioned for Leopold Stokowski, went up to his house on Fifth Avenue, played two or three notes, had a little conversation, and started playing the American Symphony. And that was my first gig, first steady type of gig. I haven't had a steady gig, I think, since 1972. I haven't had a real job.
Hmm. Yeah. Well, you've risen above it quite well.
So I played, and I was playing the Brooklyn Philharmonic, and I was playing in the Westchester thing, and St. Luke's. But I started sending in subs for rehearsals and stuff because I was doing, started getting into the studio work, and I prioritized that. Mm. So when you start sending in subs for rehearsals in freelance symphonic groups, you don't last very long. But it worked out, you know. So I started playing in Stokowski's orchestra. I've been playing at Carnegie Hall since 1966, man. Mm. In fact, I got another gig with the New England Chamber Orchestra playing in April this year. So I've been playing there for like, did the Jay-Z thing. I mean, mm-hmm. I do a lot of different things at Carnegie Hall.
Yeah.
It's a wonderful way to go through your career.
For sure,
What I leave out?
I was just curious. Like, I know we've actually had this conversation many, many years ago. You told me about how you kind of came to a crossroads where you had to make a decision whether you're going to go the orchestral route or
yeah.
And you had
right.
a foot.
I was subbing in the Philharmonic a lot, you know. And they really wanted me there.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't a hard decision for me to not play there because I was at that point doing so much. You know, I have a freelance career, but you got to remember. I've been playing in all the best jazz groups. I've been playing in
right.
all the, I mean, it's insane. I feel blessed, man.
Yeah.
You know, all the best jazz bands on all the great, a lot of the great rock and roll records and all the great freelance orchestras. I still play with Orpheus and I'll be playing again, playing with this year, playing next year on the thing in October. Playing with the Philharmonic in April. I mean, it's
yeah.
So it's still, yeah, I don't think I made it. There was one period of time, I mentioned to you earlier, when I was in my 50s, and I started saying, if I had taken a gig, I could coast.
Yeah.
But I'm not a coast type of fella, so.
Let's
know.
Talk about what, well, tell me about
you know
the
what
studio.
Happened? Wait.
No, wait.
when I never bothered showing up for the audition for the orchestra, and they got pissed. Somebody cut that out. Yeah,
seems
they got
totally sensitive to me.
Some of the guys got annoyed. Vince Penzarella. You know who Vince Penzarella?
Sure, of course.
Vince Penzarella brought me up to his apartment afterwards, and got me totally blitzed, drunk. We were both drunk, and he just stood
this
there.
This is your penalty for not showing up
yeah,
for the audition.
Yeah, he berating me.
How could I not?
How could I not? How could I? I guess they were worried maybe that I turned down a good opportunity and, maybe blew a good opportunity or something like that. Gerard Schwartz was a little bugged at me about that, too. He was lead trumpet at that time. And
well, part of you think it must have been that you had such a solid footing in the studio business at that point. You were probably emotionally
yeah, and
going
I asked my good
road.
Friend Alan Rubin, what should I do?
So, a pillar of sound judgment.
Right. So he took me down to... We were in his car. It was a 1600, old 1600 BMW, and we were sitting at that time. There was a municipal parking lot on 54th Street, and we were sitting in the basement.
These are where you make your career decisions?
Well, we were parking. I guess we had a record date or something. I don't know. We were sitting. I said, geez, I don't know. What should I do? He says, well, look, and I don't mean this. I don't believe in it. But he said, look, really an orchestra is a glorified Broadway show. And who are you going to hang out with after a concert? What are you going to do, go for quiche? So I said, you know, that's some sound thinking.
Yeah, well.
So I passed on it. I've had harder decisions to make, though. I mean, there was one time I was playing in Gil Evans' orchestra, and we were going to play with Sting in Perugia, and I got called to play with the Santa Fe Chamber Festival, and they were doing L'Histoire du Soldat, the Stravinsky piece. And I agonized over that decision for 6 months. It was an isolated gig, but those are the gigs that I have a hard time. You know, it's funny, man. Life decisions happen. People think life decisions happen slowly and this and that, but really they're not. They're boom, and then there's a decision made. But with the individual gig thing, I had to always gamble. Like, for example, I rarely ask for double scale on a recording session. I know like in the West Coast, those guys are always, and maybe even here, they're doing, I don't even know. Because I figured once you start asking for more money on a gig, the employer feels he owns you. Mm. Maybe I'm wrong. Mm. But I would rather not feel owned and be independent. And I was able to send in subs all over the place. Like even with Mince's band on recordings. You mentioned Matt Finder's one of your buddies. I even sent him on part of a recording to Mince's. Always sent in subs every place I went. And people were lenient, you know. And I always went where I was wanted the most.
Hmm. Let's just, before we, I want to
I'm going too fast. Right?
No, it's all good. I want to talk a good deal about Bob Minster's band. Yeah. Before we get to that, let's just talk about, once you established yourself and you were the guy playing bass trombone in the studios, tell us about the sections that you were working with and the various folks that, you know, were a part of that scene. Obviously, the names,
they were units. Even when I came in, there was units led by, let's say, Bernie Glow, and then there were guys like Ernie Royal and Phil Bodner and Romeo Pinefoy and all these guys. And Irby was in part of that group, Irby mm-hmm. Green, and probably Frank Rehak and all of that. And then there were other guys too, like Joe Shepley and a bunch of those guys. They did a lot of the rock and roll stuff and things like that. Well, we had that too. There's always cliques, man. You know that. But you had a group too.
Sure.
My group, I can't believe it was so lucky. The trumpets and these guys were my buddies. Were Alan Rubin, Lou Soloff, John Faddis, Randy Brecker. The saxophone players were Michael Brecker, David Sanborn, George Young, Ronnie Cuba, me, Mico Minardo, Wayne Andre. We couldn't wait to get to work.
Yeah.
Because it was so much fun.
Musical and personal.
It was just so much fun. And we even rented a studio apartment, Ruben and I, Lou Delgado. Lou Delgado was another one of the guys in the saxophone section. Lou did all the double redoubling and stuff like that. He became the contractor Saturday Night Live. You know, so it was all, is that what you meant?
Yeah, that's the question? Exactly.
Yeah. And the bottom line of the whole thing was quality. Mm-hmm. And we think, we hope. That was the bottom line of the whole thing was, you got to do the job. Part of the reason that it was quality based was we were so busy working so many dates. I mean, you had to be able to get the guys out without using the overtime because everybody was booked back to back. So if you were a type of guy who couldn't get the guys out, they lose money.
Yeah,
it's money.
You know. And all the studios, all the studios were in Midtown at that point, right?
Yes, so the studios in Midtown. I used to walk. A lot of guys would cab it, but I used to walk and put my trombone on a cart because I was always into trying to, I wasn't an exerciser per se, so I always looked, you know, that caveman approach to exercising where you do what you do what you do as your profession and that's your exercise.
Yeah.
So I would always try to make it a little more strenuous. That was very interesting too. I was playing in Thad Jones's band at the same time I was subbing a lot in the Philharmonic. And I remember there was one jingle that John Faddis and I were on. We weren't going to go to Rochester. There was going to be the band was playing up in Rochester, and we had subs up there. But at the last minute, we decided to take a plane up. And it turned out there was a public service TV show, Thad Jones. Jimmy Nepper was in the band at that time. What a gorgeous player this kid was, right? Butter Jackson. I used to carry Butter's bags for him. He was an old man at that time, probably younger than I am, you know, not. But we went up there, and Jimmy got a little bug. Jimmy would get bugged every now and then. So he pushed the microphone over to me. He didn't want any part of the microphone. So on the public service TV show, all you heard was George Mraz, John Faddis, and me. You know what I mean? It was that kind of, you know what I mean when I say all you heard, but that was the basic what you heard. Simultaneously to that, I was playing in the Philharmonic at the same time, and I think people started putting two and two together, and within a week of that whole experience, I started doing at least 7 recording sessions a week.
Wow.
And then a couple of weeks after that, like it was like almost like overnight, then a couple of weeks after that, I was up to my between 9 and 20. It was nuts, you know that. Yeah. It was nuts.
I only got the tail end. I was never in the...
And we loved it, man. It wasn't work. We loved it because we had this boisterous... That was part of our modus operandi. You know, boisterous, have a good time, make the music have a good... I don't know if they could do that today, though.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
A little more serious today.
Yeah.
So we just loved it. It was just a party. And we got the jobs done on time.
Yeah.
You know, that kind of thing.
That's an awesome awesome story. Thanks for
sharing. I mean,
let's jump ahead to Bob Minster's band. I think we're both big fans. I was always a huge Minster fan. And that's where I really first, I think the first time I heard you was you were giving a recital at 92nd Street Y maybe. And a buddy of mine, Jim Martin, a great bass trombone player in St. Louis, said, "You got to come hear Dave Taylor." So he took me down and we were blown away. It was an amazing recital.
Thanks, man.
But then right at that same period, I was on Buddy Rich's band. Whenever we'd come back to New York, we would always run down to 7th Avenue South and hope to catch Mincer's band. And in those days, the band was, I mean, it was absolutely star-studded. A lot of the guys you just described is
right.
Yourself.
Barry Rogers.
Barry Rogers, Keith O'Quinn.
Keith O'Quinn.
Great trombone section. Mike Brecker.
Right.
David Sanborn. Yeah. Roger Rosenberg was in
yeah,
that.
Yeah, Roger.
Lawrence Feldman.
Lawrence.
Peter Erskine. Will Lee. Don Grolnick.
Will Lee.
Yeah.
Will Lee. I can't say that name too many times. Will
but
Lee, man.
The band was... you know, needless to say, star-studded. Bob's charts were amazing, of course.
Right.
He seemed to have an affinity for writing great bass trombone parts for you. And it also seemed to me like, I don't know, I mean, you were well-known, of course, even at that point, but that band seemed like, to me, it gave you a national and international visibility, or at least it upped
it. I never even realized
you know.
That.
But I've always thought
I was
that
always
kind of...
in it just for learning. You have to remember, I started late. So I always felt I'm playing catch-up. I still feel like I'm playing catch-up. It's like... I didn't really
what did you think
feel...
What was the feeling like in the band at that point? Did you guys feel like, wow, this is a special thing? Or it was just like cool music and we're going to go
Well,
play?
It was cool music and it was a special thing. We loved it. But you have to remember, too, I was always juggling gigs.
Mm-hmm.
So even though I took every gig seriously when I was there, I was always... Here, like, for example, I once played a recital at the Guggenheim Museum just before one of the record dates.
Mm.
And I ran over to the... I mean, I was always juggling the thing. And but the parts that Bob wrote for me were incredible, man.
Yeah.
Incredible. Yeah. I remember once we I forget the name of the first record, but Mike Brecker turned around because I had some kind of a written out part. It was fives over fours, and I still remember the big smile he gave me, you know. And I was always worried about my style and this and that, and I wanted to further my emotional impact on the horn and stuff like that. I knew I was a pretty good technician. By that point, I knew I was a good technician. But I was always trying to grow. There was one time when we were rehearsing, I forget where we were, when Peter Erskine and Don Grolnick, do you know the name Don Grolnick?
Of course.
Of course,
sure,
right.
Of course.
All right. They were like kind of looking and pointing at me and laughing and blah, blah, blah. And I went up to them and I went, what? And they were grooving on how I was personalizing the parts.
Mm.
And that was a big thing for me.
Wow.
Yeah, it gave me courage. You know, you always need courage, man.
Let me ask you this, because we've had, I would say we probably have a different approach on that, but
you
do bring a personality, and that can be a great thing. It can be, sometimes to me, I wonder if that's the
excess,
right thing to do.
It can be excess, not enough, too much. Not, yeah.
What's your feeling about that? Like something like Bob's band, where clearly he writes a lot of independent stuff for the Barry and bass trombone and bass together. But you're still part of a smaller ensemble at that point. What's your feeling about how far will you go in terms of personalizing?
I always loved Duke Ellington's band.
Okay.
I'm a freak for Duke. In fact, I got to record with Duke Ellington's band. I did the New Orleans Suite record.
Oh,
and
wow.
I was amazing, man. I was in my 20s at that time. I always loved how you maintained your individual personality and somehow blended in the overview of the band based on your articulation. If you use a hard articulation and you're not exactly in time with somebody, you're going to be whack out. But if you're using a kind of a soft articulation, you can kind of smooth over the rough edges. Yes, sometimes it's excess. Look, I was doing a record, a Frank Sinatra record, L.A. Is My Lady.
Mm-hmm, sure.
That was a major event with Quincy Jones and all of that. It was A&R 799, Phil Ramone. They filmed it. And they wrote me a part, a George Robertsy type of part. I remember consciously saying, I do not want to play this part like George.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember, this is a terrible thing to say, I remember saying to myself, I'd rather be wrong than sound like another guy.
Mm-hmm.
And so I messed with the time of the part. It worked out great, and it wasn't that far off. That's part of the problem, too. A lot of times I think, you know, these little devil's in the details, these little personality things, I often wonder if it's the lack of personality that killed the studio scene. Maybe it made it easier for electronics to duplicate what we do when you don't use enough personality. I don't know, you know. But I encourage my students, look it. Debussy did not want to write like Wagner. I'm sure Coltrane didn't want to play like Byrd. I mean, you make conscious.
Clearly, yeah.
You might be wrong. Yeah, you might be excessive. But how do you get to that?
Well, that was the question. I think it was a great answer, and I think you're clearly What I gained from that is that you have a thought process.
I have a thought process.
You've thought it out.
There's times to do it, times not to do it.
I mean,
if you sense you're not being in the spirit of the music, then you'd be foolish to. That's a hard thing to determine.
Yeah, no, of course.
That's a hard thing to determine. But I tell you one thing, if you're going to start fooling around like that, you better have practiced your scales. you better be technically on the money, and the sound better be pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, if you're gonna fool around like that.
Yeah. Well, let's jump over to your solo career
for
a minute, because that's kind of where you've put most of your energy in the last couple of decades anyway.
Right.
You've built an incredible career just as a soloist, not counting all the work you did here in New York. What was your motivation for starting it? I mean, clearly, like I said at the beginning, clearly was not thought of as a solo instrument when you were jumping into it. Would that be safe to say?
Yeah, it would be. I mean, I studied at Juilliard with Luciano Berio, Jacob Druckmann. I was very good friends with a female composer named Lucia Lugachevsky. She took to my work. This is when we were students. But she wrote for the Eric Hawkins Dance Company. She was Edgar Varese's only student in the States, and maybe the only student, period. She was pretty avant-garde. Her music was so fast, wild, and woolly that it was my first real jump into improvisation.
Hmm.
You would try to play her music. It was going so fast, though, that you would have to get the shapes and get the notes in between. And it gave me a real feeling of improvisation. Luciano Berio, when he taught his classes, always talked about the modern music scene with joy. And that, you know, when he spoke about John Cage, who I met and hung out with, and so I met all these guys, you know, and I was trained in that area. I played in modern music groups. It was the most natural thing for me to do to find a voice. I couldn't find a voice. I started late. I kept the horn on my face hours and hours, 6-7 hours a day. I mean, when I was a kid, man, it was like, even when I was married, had my first kid, I'd be in a room. And with the studio scene, you don't play that much.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd be practicing at night. I was like a 24/7. I wouldn't call myself a 24/7 guy now, because I'm more directed. The studio scene is kind of, I was lucky. I phased out of the studio scene as the studio scene was phasing out. I kind of made a kind of cat of nine lives thing. But I had been concentrating on recitals and stuff way before you met me, even before I was in the studio scene. As I said, with the studio scene, a lot of guys go in wanting to be studio musicians. I never really went in there wanting to be a studio musician. The beauty of the studio musician thing for the bass trombone, it was closer to chamber music. I mean, and when I got out of Juilliard, disco was the big thing.
Mm-hmm.
Disco was an even eighth note proposition. And I was an orchestral player, and that's more or less an even eighth note, you know what I'm saying? And Bach was one of my heroes, so that's more, the Baroque is more that whole thing. So I was really a good fit for that. And I don't know, I just went wherever I went. I had a vision, but I didn't know clearly what the vision was. The vision was use every gig you could to advance your craft. When I was in the studios, sight reading was my... I learned how to sight read when I was at Juilliard, because I used to take out piano books, I used to take out clarinet books, violin books, and I would just, like the piano books, no matter what it was, Chopin or whatever, I would read through the bass lines. And if there's something I couldn't play, or if there was an arpeggio in the bass line, I'd arpeggiate.